sweet dreams till sunbeams find you. Sweet dreams that leave all worries behind you. But in your dreams, whatever they be, dream a little dream of me.
Good morning. You are listening to KSQD Santa Cruz, K-Squid 90.7 FM, streaming live at ksqd.org. I am Catherine Bell, and this is The Dream Journal, a weekly show where we explore the healing powers of your nighttime dreams through conversations with dream experts and with you. In the words of Carl Jung, who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakens. Today's music is called Erionic, created fresh for you today. And you can find copies of this music at narrativespecies.com. Personally, I use the music to listen to while I'm writing or reading. It's a wonderful background. Metaphors and the Self in a Zombie Pandemic Dream. We'll be talking with Professor Jeannette Mageo, PhD, about her lifelong work and many books on dreams, and also about her upcoming keynote presentation at the IASD conference in Tucson in July. This is Catherine Bell of Experiential Dreamwork, and welcome to The Dream Journal. The Dream Journal is also a podcast, so you can look for that in all of the regular podcast platforms and also on the KSQD website at ksqd.org/the-dream-journal. 150 shows archived for you. So review The Dream Journal, especially on iTunes, and subscribe. But most importantly, tell your friends. You know, it gives you a chance to talk about dreams. And you probably would like to talk about your dreams more. Why not? There's something about dream sharing that is very powerful. So tell them about this podcast you've been listening to and give it as a chance to talk about your own dreams. So I'm going to start with my own personal dreams, the way I always do. And I woke up this morning with a dream about the desert. I was in the desert, and there's a moment where it's super crowded, and I'm kind of worried I'm competing with other people for space. And then there's a shift, and I'm back in the desert. But this time, it's me, and there's a band playing. I can't see them, but I know they're somewhere over in a certain direction, and it's danceable music. And I will say music festivals are something I really, really enjoy. And so even though nobody was dancing, I tend to not let that stop me. And so in the dream, I just got up and I was dancing. And there's just something about being in the desert with a beautiful setting sun and dancing. It felt a little bit like this Burning Man theme of mine that listeners will know is a regular theme. And yet here it's just me dancing, and I have a companion somewhere about, and I don't really see them. But there's a sense that I have two chairs because there's two of us. So I get this companionship, and I get to really relax and dance, which I really enjoy. So I appreciate my dream maker sending me that dream, getting me ready for the journal, because it is always a bit of a dance. You never know exactly what's going to happen. So we will take call-ins during the last 20 minutes of the show. Tony Rusimano will be here a little bit later to get the phones. But you can email us at any time at onair@ksqd.org. We haven't had many emails lately, but go ahead and send us an email. Rick Kleffel is manning the board, and he'll be checking emails throughout the show. That's onair, O-N-A-I-R, at ksqd.org. Okay, I'd like to say hello to Jeannette Mageo. Hello.
Hello.
So good to have you on the show today. So Jeannette Mageo is a professor of anthropology at Washington State University. Her work focuses on dreaming and the self, on child development, on how subjectivity, identity, and emotion evolve out of cultural and historical experiences. Professor Mageo has published 11 books with major academic presses, including 4 books on dreams. So, Jeannette, you are a professor, and you have a long career in writing books about anthropology and dreaming in particular. I wonder if you could give us a little bit of an origin story. How did you get started with dreaming in particular?
Well, actually, I started right there in Santa Cruz.
Oh, that's right. A local Santa Cruz for a long time. What was that all about?
Well, I was in the History of Consciousness program. And so we had to be kind of entrepreneurial about TA ships, sort of find them in various other departments in the university. Mm. So there was this poet named Bill Willard, who originally he was Brother Antoninus. Anyway, he was a famous poet in his time, and he was doing a class, I believe it was on Jungian psychology.
Uh-huh.
And so I approached him and I said, well, I'd like to be your TA and as your TA do a workshop on dreams from multiple perspectives. Mm. And he said, yes. So I did that for a number of years.
So you were already interested in dreams at the time, it seems like.
Yes. It's hard for me to trace the origin of it. It goes back before my remembrance, I guess.
So something that you've always been interested in. That's something I hear often from folks who are deep into dreams. There are many people who seem to just not pay any attention at all to their dreams. And others like you and me, it sounds like, who have always been fascinated by these nighttime apparitions.
Yes.
Yeah. I wonder if there's anything that you could tell us about some dreams that have been meaningful to you in the past, if there's a particular dream that you would be comfortable sharing or a pattern of dreaming that was helpful to you over the years.
Well, here's a dream that I think was very transitional in my life. I think I had it in my late 20s. And I was a man in this dream.
Mm-hmm.
And no, actually, it started earlier than that. It started with a lucid dream. Mm. One of the few lucid dreams I've had in my life, where I'm in Santa Cruz, in sort of a Victorian Santa Cruz house. And I realize I'm dreaming. And my best friend from high school is there. This is many years after high school. But at any rate, her name is Barbara. Mm-hmm. And so I say, Barbara. I'm dreaming, you know? So anyway, then I do what I guess a lot of people do when they get a lucid dream. I fly around.
Right.
But then I think, you know, I go outside and fly around. But then I think, well, I should do something more significant. This is just entertainment, right? And then I flip to another scene, and it's not lucid. And I'm a male with other men, walking with other men.
Mm.
And we're walking to some kind of confrontation with the bad people, right?
Yep.
And we arrive, and there's a lot of karate and stuff like that. And, you know, my team is fighting their team. But there's a head person who seems to be somewhat of a young man, not, you know, not like a teenager, but maybe early 20s or something like that. And he and I are fighting and grappling. And then he gets this tactile poison on his finger, which he rubs on me. And I know I'm going to die. Hmm. But we are, through the struggling, we are a kind of an embrace. And I say to him, my brother. That's it.
Oh, you say my brother. Okay. And what was there's something about the tactile poison that feels really intense to me. Sometimes for me, the dying dreams have to do with letting go of who I have been and opening up to something new that I don't know about yet. And that's just one of the things that speaks to me from that dream. But
That makes sense. Yeah. I think it was a transitional dream in some sense or another, having to do with my assertiveness.
Yeah, right.
Or Jungian terms, my masculine side, right?
That's right. The animus for for the men. Now, you're a PhD, and so you have been, was your topic related to dreaming, or was it more about anthropology?
Oh, well, so it was, actually, my dissertation, I guess that's what's easiest to talk about, was a kind of anthropological critique of Jung's psychology.
Oh, okay. So there were things that you found that you did not agree with in Jung's psychology, sounds like.
Well, it meant a great deal to me at that time, but it was based on the anthropology of the early and mid-20th century, which in many ways we've gone beyond. This is probably too strong a word, but in some ways it was racist. You know, his idea of the savage mind, so to speak, was associated with the way people think in tribal societies and the disparaging views that we have of the, you know, we had at that time. You know, we thought of them as thinking in some kind of primitive way.
Right.
Participation mystique, Lévi-Bruhl, he borrowed a lot of ideas from Lévi-Bruhl. So, so I was trying to kind of revision the psychology from a more recent anthropological perspective.
Right. Yeah, that certainly is something, a critique I've heard of Jung before, of him having a racist view of the world and how that limited the things that he has access to. So you have studied anthropology in a more modern term, and I want to get to that soon. But I'd like to start with the title of your talk that you're going to be giving at the IASD Dream Conference coming up in July, which I was just fascinated by the title, Metaphors and the Self in a Zombie Pandemic Dream. Can you say a little bit more about what do you mean by that? What is a zombie pandemic dream?
Well, this is a dream that, so I have this long-term dream study going on at Washington State where I teach a course on, it's actually on the self, but it's very much also about dreaming. Mm-hmm. In fact, the book we read is my 2003 book, Dreaming in the Self.
Yeah,
We read a few other more, you know, other anthropological texts as well. But they have dream assignments every semester, and they can choose to contribute those to my dream study or not. But many do, and so I have a big corpus of dreams to draw upon and to think about and to think with. And so this was a dream from a chimero of indigenous person from Guam, Guam hasn't been my particular study, but I am a expert on Pacific Islands cultures. So, you know, so I had kind of a lead into that. And he lived in the States for a while too. So he's very much a bicultural person, but he had a dream. So this was from dreams collected during the pandemic. And he had this dream that, there were zombies all about, but they didn't look like zombies. They kind of looked like regular people. But they spread zombieism through droplets in the air.
Oh wow, that sounds like the pandemic for sure.
So he associated that very closely with the pandemic, which had started and was pretty full blown at that time, and. Also, he'd been, he was very frustrated with Americans not wearing masks. Mm-hmm. And the university is situated in a fairly rural location, and he'd been to a neighboring farming town the day before the dream, and nobody was wearing masks. And Pacific Islanders in general are very identified with their families. Their families are so important to them. They take their sense of self a lot from their families. And it includes elderly people, you know, who are very vulnerable to COVID-19. So it was really driving them crazy, and it sparked this dream.
Okay. And so you're going to be exploring this particular dream as part of your presentation and the metaphors of that dream and the self.
Yes, I have a theory about metaphors and dreams, which is multiple dreams. He turned in a number of dreams. And with, you know, the great thing about collecting them in the context of this course is they all do their own analyses of dreams. So I have not only the dreams to build on, but personal associations and their analyses. And but at any rate, he gave me several dreams which illustrate this idea that I have about dreams, that there are three kinds of metaphors in dreams, which I have names for: sensory metaphors, cultural metaphors, and personal metaphors. Sensory metaphors are they're the, you might call, the geographic orientations of the dream. So, for instance, in the zombie pandemic dream, so he, you know, he gets this message from his phone that everybody should go to the roof of a building, which actually evokes some zombie movies. He'd been watching zombie movies all his life in Guam, too. And so he and his family go to the roof of the building, and then they realize they don't have enough food. And so he's got to go down. And then the zombies, you know, so, but if he puts on a mask, the zombies think he is one of them, and so they don't presume. but so then he brings the food back up the building, and his family take off the mask to eat, and then the zombies start scaling the sides of the building. So the predominant geography, direction of movement in the dream, is up, down. And so I think you find these kinds of directions of movement in dreams. And I think they're metaphors for larger existential issues, really big issues in dreams. So with my American students, I found that this kind of direction of movement was a metaphor for socioeconomic things. Like, you know, like moving up to a higher socioeconomic class or having more money or stuff like that. But for him, I thought it had to do with rising emotions, which, you know, which his emotions had come way up in response to Americans not wearing masks. And kind of threatened to escape his control. And so I thought that was the existential issue at the root of the dream. And I have a lot of evidence for that. But so, and these sensory existential issues are kind of universal. What I also believe in dreams, you find in dreams, are cultural metaphors. These, I think, are actually metaphors for cultural models, and which you may not know what a, or your listeners may not know what a cultural model is, but it's what it is publicly held and shared ideas about how to navigate a domain of experience, about what that domain is and how to navigate it. So, you know, for instance, the family. Americans have certain ideas about what family is. That it's a group of closely related, genetically related relatives who are supposed to feel close to one another. Well, that's not the way family is constructed in all societies. In some societies, families are much larger, more loosely connected relatives who, you know, are supposed to love one another. But what love means differs a lot, and it might not be. Might have to not have to do with sharing affection or something like that. So, you know, it's, these are cultural models. And I think the thing is with cultural models is that, so you, they're like the air we breathe, you know, we get born into them like a language. And so they become our assumed world. But even though, you know, they, we use them all our lives and, we couldn't do without them any more than we could do without language. They're always only partial. They come out of a specific social and historical experience.
Yeah, and they, Well, I want to get much more into the specifics of American culture and like what do Americans typically dream about. And I want to take a short break first. I want to introduce my guest. This is Dr. Jeannette Mageo and from WSU up in Washington State. And you are listening to The Dream Journal on KSQD 90.7 FM, streaming live at ksqd.org. And I am your host, Catherine Bell. You can send us an email to onair@ksqd.org. Okay, this is The Dream Journal with Catherine Bell, and you are listening to KSQD 90.7 FM, streaming live at ksqd.org in the Santa Cruz area at 90.7 FM. And my guest today is Dr. Jeannette Mageo. So good to have you on the show, Jeannette.
Good to be here.
Yeah. Great. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about American culture, like American anthropology. Like sometimes I think of anthropology as studying other cultures, and yet our own culture is as unique as any other. And I'm wondering, especially with your Dream Collection project, you must have a very wide view or wide sampling of American dreams, at least of people in college, a certain age and a certain socioeconomic status. But I'm wondering if you see certain themes that are common in American dreamers that are maybe different from dreamers in other cultures.
Well, I see people in dreams. Again, I think there are three metaphors for three different types of things people think about in dreams. But so what I think people think about a lot in dreams is their personal problems, of course,
yes,
but also their cultural models.
Right.
Because as I was saying, I think these fit each of us only more or less well. So we're kind of a little uncomfortable with them. And sometimes, although not necessarily consciously, very much at odds with them. And so I think we kind of revise them in dreams.
Mm. Can you give an example of that, or what does that look like?
Well, so one model that I've written about and that I've seen students work on is what I call the American Dream model, which say, for instance, in the 2008 period, the Great Recession period, people, undergraduates were really worried about their future and worried if, especially lower income people, worried if, the American dream was just a dream or whether they had some real chance. Uh-huh. And so I found this kind of questioning of the model coming up a lot in dreams. Another model that I've seen young women struggle with is what I call the pinup model for sexuality, which, a model we're all very familiar with. But certainly not a model for femininity or feminine sexuality in all times or places. Right. Another model that I've written about is what I call super masculinity, which we're very familiar with, although I started writing about it before it was quite as blatant as it is now, and actually was told, oh no, that was just from your childhood. It's not like that. But of course, that's not true. And so that's something I've seen people working with, questioning, working with, worrying about, so to speak, revising in dreams.
Right. But, and then, of course, there's power, too, that, getting power and saving, being in power, being under someone else's power. Surely those are common themes in American dreams. In fact, that's the title of one of your books, and from 2016, Dreaming Culture, Meanings, Models, and Power in U.S. American Dreams. So something you've obviously thought quite a bit about.
Right. Well, power infiltrates all of these models. Mm-hmm. I mean, power is a part of all of these models. these models are what social scientists of the more humanistic variety at least call hegemonic, which is to say they're dominant. You know, these, it's like a language. I mean, you can't not speak your language. You can put it to new purposes. You can write beautiful poetry that changes the language for everyone forever, but you still got to use the language. And the same is true as the models. So they have power over you. They're hegemonic. And that doesn't mean it's impossible to change them, but it ain't easy. And so, but in dreams, you're enlisting the deepest energies of the self to kind of not only grapple with your own problems, I think, but to grapple with and change the world.
Yeah, there's a quote from, I think it's Jeremy Taylor, who would say that dreams are the workshop of evolution, and certainly on the cultural level, most of all, on the personal level, for sure, perhaps most of all, but then after that, the cultural level, so that there's an evolution, perhaps, that we are tinkering around with and experimenting with in our dreams.
Yes, if we're still an evolving species, I think that's place we are doing it.
Yes, yes. Well, I think any living creature is evolving, and the dreams do seem to have a lot to say. Certainly my personal dreams have had a lot of influence on my personal evolution, and so it makes sense that they would be responding to and pushing the culture as well, because what else is the culture but made up of individuals?
Right, right. I really think that if you're doing good work in your dreams, you're contributing to the culture and the change.
Oh, well, thank you. I feel like I got some validation there, because I'm fond of saying the most important activism I do is my personal dream work. And I think that's basically what you're saying. So I do feel like that these things ripple out as people do explore their and do their inner work, which can be about dreams, but it can be about other things as well, that this kind of inner work that we do really affects our families and our culture as well, more broadly, so that this inner work is not just navel gazing or something that is self-indulgent, that there is a way that we can really influence the culture at large by doing our own inner work.
Absolutely. I mean, that's a belief that's been strong in Asian cultures forever, right? That you want to support the monks in the monasteries because they're what maintain the spirituality, the level of development of the culture as a whole. But I think it's true of all of us that in as much as we take responsibility for our own development, we're doing something important for our collectives.
Huh. I think that's wonderful. I want to mention the name or the title of your new book, 2022, The Mimetic Nature of Dream Mentation, American Selves in Reformation. And I wonder if you'd say a little bit about that. I mean, we were talking about reformation here, perhaps on a personal as well as a cultural level. And I'm curious about this mimetic nature of dream mentation. What is dream mentation and what is the mimetic nature? What is that all about?
So, you know, kind of going back to my earlier remarks about Jung and how Jung had a strange concept of, his idea, his grand idea of the unconscious, right, is that he has this idea that it thinks in this sort of mystical, blurry way, which was also associated with tribal peoples at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So, one of the people in anthropology who tried to think more, who started the discipline thinking more about what this thinking was like, was Claude Lévi-Strauss, who's the father of structuralism. At any rate, this is kind of my contribution to that tradition. I think that, so if we're doing work in dreams, I think it's intellectual work. I think we're thinking. And I think we're thinking in a mimetic way. Although here the distinction between thinking and feeling is moot because, the kind of thinking we do in dreams is also feeling. Mm. But at any rate, you probably noticed that in many of your dreams, a lot of things in the dreams are like things in waking life, but not quite.
True. These discrepancies are always fascinating to me.
Right.
Yeah.
So the way I think mimetic thinking works is it's an image-based kind of thinking where you repeat an image from somewhere else, mm-hmm. and that specifies a subject of thought, and then you alter it, and the alterations are comments on the subject.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Uh-huh. So all those little variations, those are commentaries on a subject that, again, has come from outside. It's come from the collective, the shared world, and it comes into your dreams, and you're thinking about it, and that thought is reflected in the way you change that in your dream.
Okay, interesting. So often people say, well, oh, that was just like a, you know, a day residue. That's something I saw yesterday. But I've always thought that if you saw many, many things yesterday, and this one particular thing showed up in your dream, and it's interesting that you bring the idea that there's a comment on it, like if there's a little alteration, and that there was something important about that one particular thing that showed up in my dream that I happened to encounter yesterday. And then I'm going to bring that to my own work, to think about any discrepancies as like a comment. And like, this is like, well, this is the part that doesn't quite work for me. This is the part I want to change. Is that kind of thing you're talking about, Jeannette?
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
To go back to, this dream that I was talking about, Nino's dream,
yeah.
That's not his real name, of course, but well, maybe a name anyway. So I told you he dreamt of zombies.
Yeah. Yep.
But the zombies were just a little different than the zombies he'd seen in the movies all his life. And the way they were different was they were zombies, but they looked like regular human beings. The only thing that differentiated them from regular human beings was that they were eating other people. In other words, they were cannibals.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Right.
And so the way I think that works is that Nino was thinking in his dreams about, God, these Americans who won't wear masks, what's the problem, you know? But I think he was thinking they were savages. And so in the Pacific, you know, there's this long history in anthropology of Pacific Islanders being thought of as savages and cannibals, right? And so, you know, the whole history of colonialism is based on, well, we're helping them evolve,
yeah.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And their, you know, their supposedly unevolved nature was evident in their savagery, and their savagery was evident in their cannibalism, which there wasn't a lot of cannibalism in the Pacific. This was all a fantasy and a projection, or mostly a fantasy and a projection of these Westerners who needed some kind of justification for what they were doing, you know, for the exploitation and the pejorative attitudes and everything that went with it.
Right.
So anyway, so in Nino's dream, the zombies stand for unmasked Americans, but they're also connected to, they're cannibals. That's their one distinguishing feature.
Mm-hmm.
And what I think that relates back to is he's saying, we're not the savages, you're the savages. You know? So anyway, that's an example.
Yeah, no, this is great. I must say that I have a personal association that cannibalism is okay if I throw it out there.
Sure.
Yeah, you know, you start hearing dreams and I start having associations, and for me, cannibalism is something about eating somebody else. And so there's like, I've taken over who they are. Like I am maybe using their energy, maybe not literally their flesh, but there's a way that I sometimes feel, I certainly used to often feel totally subsumed by people around me. Like I was giving up my flesh for them. And that I would like imagine that others were kind of eating my flesh in that way. That was a way that was kind of a metaphor for my sense of feeling consumed and powerless, and that imagining that people who were in power, had power over me, were cannibalizing my flesh.
See, this is another example of what I'm talking about dreams being social and borrowing upon and speaking back to a shared world. So cannibalism has a special meaning for a Pacific Islander that it wouldn't have for you, right?
Oh, yes, yes. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Because they come from a world where racism has taken that particular form, where they've been seen as less evolved, as savage. Oh, your ancestors were cannibals, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So So it has this special poignant meaning for them.
I see.
Which it might be something they would need to speak back to.
Right, right. Whereas I don't take it so personally because as an American, I don't have that in my history. I've not been accused of that. My European ancestors have not been accused of cannibalism.
Right.
Yes.
We probably have to do some work to see what the particular meaning of cannibalism was for you. If you see what I mean.
Right. I really do. And it really brings up a caution in working with folks from a variety of cultures. I mean, we have a variety of family cultures in within one larger culture, like in one country like the U.S. But then working from other cultures that their metaphors may be very different. And I feel like I'm so often asking my dream people to educate me. Like, what does that mean to you? What is your association? Because it's so individual and taking on not just the individual differences, but the cultural differences is really important. Jeannette, I want to take a short break here. I'm going to play a little bit more of Rick's music, which was the request today. And I'll just let folks know this is the Dream Journal. My name is Catherine Bell. My guest is Jeannette Mageo, a PhD. And this is K-Squid 90.7 FM, streaming live at ksqd.org. My name is Catherine Bell, and my guest today is Jeannette Mageo, M-A-G-E-O, and I want to open up the phones. Tony Russomano is available to take your call. The number is 831-900-5773. If you have a question for the professor or for me, or if you have a dream that you'd like to share, or any comment on these topics about the cultural impact of dreams and any of the other things we've been talking about. Dr. Mageo, I wanted to ask you a question of why don't dreams just come out and say it? Like, this is one of my enduring frustrations with dreams is you never know. It's always like hinting at, it's ambiguous, it's vague, and if the dreams are really trying to help us move our evolve us, our personal evolution, then why aren't they more explicit?
I think they are.
Darn it.
They just speak a different language, right? They speak an image language, an image-based language, which is quite different from a word language. But in the images, they are speaking with great precision and clarity. It's just, you've got to speak dream.
Yeah, so how would I learn to speak dream better? How do I learn to recognize these images and what they are suggesting, or what my inner self is thinking about?
Well, it's an ongoing process, so they speak a lot like poetry speaks, like pretty good poetry speaks. We're all good poets in our dreams, but the techniques that you're familiar with, Jungian techniques, Gestalt techniques, many different techniques. They're all extremely useful, right? Because we tend to live in our conscious minds when we're awake, which is our word minds, even though we live in our image-based minds when we dream. But the question is, it's clear enough in our image-based mind and to our image-based mind, mm-hmm. but it's a question of translating it into words, into our, conscious mind, and we might not have all the words for it, right? Mm-hmm. But in all those techniques that you're familiar with are very useful in making that translation.
Right. And maybe dreams come from a more primitive part of the brain where there just aren't a lot of words, and images are what it uses.
Well, I think that's a mistake.
Okay.
Seeing the image-based mind as primitive.
Oh, yes.
Less evolved, you know, less clear.
Well, not less evolved, but maybe more like part of the body.
Well, what is true is that it's the body can speak through the image-based mind in a way that it can't speak through the word-based mind. So people often will anticipate a major disease several months before any other diagnostic mechanism will show it, right, because the body can represent its meanings in images. Okay. It's not as good at representing its meanings in words. Words are just too abstract, too far away.
I just realized I'm falling prey to body racism against my idea that it's primitive. Hey, Jeannette, we have a caller on the line. I want to introduce Skylar from Pullman, Washington. Thank you so much for calling, Skylar.
Oh, you're welcome. Glad to be here.
Yeah, good. What can we do for you? What are you thinking?
I have a question for the professor.
Perfect. Okay.
From a psychoanalytic perspective, or any other perspective you want to touch on, what do you think the importance of including culture in dream analysis is?
So we've been talking about making that translation. Well, one of the things that I've been saying is that dreams are very much engaged with your personal life, the traditional territory of psychoanalysis, but they are also very much engaged in with your collective life, with your culture, with what's going on in your society. And so they can't be fully understood, I don't think, without including that dimension. And in fact, I also believe that, psychoanalytic methods are so useful. You know, the free associative method that Freud used, doing free association is extremely useful and makes so much sense in terms of what we know about dreams now, that dreams are based on memories, and that your memories and your associations, those centers of your brain turn on when you're dreaming. So it really makes sense that through association, you can kind of get back to the subject that you're dreaming about. But also, psychoanalysts talk about something they call defenses, which is, defenses are there to stop you from figuring out what's going on in your deeper self or what's going on in your dreams. Mm-hmm. Because, the conscious mind defends itself in all sorts of ways. It's kind of practically oriented. It wants to get certain things done, to fulfill the demands of your society and to be the person that you're supposed to be.
So you think those defenses are very culturally defined as so many other things?
Yes, I do. They are of the sort that Freud talked about, but also I think they're culturally defined in as much as the sort of person you're supposed to be is culturally defined. But also going back to those models are part of, the sort of person you're supposed to be, or the family you're supposed to have, or the life you're supposed to have, or the way you're supposed to be a woman, or the way you're supposed to be sexual, or any of those things, they're all culturally defined.
True.
And in as much as they're partial, they don't include all of you. And so they suggest certain defenses against whatever is not included. So I think that the kind of dynamics that psychoanalysts describe are right and true. But I think that we're defending ourselves more than against an Oedipus complex or, some universal thing that psychoanalysts talk about.
Skylar, I wonder if you have any experience with this, or have you found cultural themes coming up in your own dreams, or I wonder what else you have to say about this. What has been your experience?
Yeah, I've definitely seen cultural influence. Particularly interested in media entering into the dream through, American culture.
Are you saying their media shows up in your dreams, or what do you mean by the media here?
Yeah, media, like TV shows and books and stuff like that.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I did my master's thesis on American dreams during the onset of the pandemic.
Oh, interesting.
And I definitely saw certain themes coming up through cultural models.
Oh, well, we'll have Deirdre Barrett on the show in a few more weeks, but I'm curious, what did you find, Skylar? What were typical themes?
There was a lot of preoccupation with the American Dream model and where people were headed with the economic collapse, which is what I was sort of looking at, or the economic shutdown. People were at home, so a lot of the themes were isolation, preoccupation with work, preoccupation with future, so things like that.
Mm. Okay, that makes sense, yeah. So what else? Do you have any other questions for the professor, or any personal dreams, or what has been your experience with with the pandemic itself? I mean, because you were probably doing your research during the pandemic while you were researching the pandemic.
Yeah, everything was a pandemic. Yeah, I also found that people were getting proper sleep, so as you sleep, your REM cycle gets longer. And so they were going all the way to the end proper REM cycle. So people were overall having more dreams and remembering their dreams and having bizarre dreams,
Right. Well, there is something about getting a full night's sleep that lets the dreams finish, because the dreams do cluster toward the time, the hours that we wake up, that later in the night. And if we have a short night because we have to get up and go to work, then we miss out on a certain amount of the dreaming. And even certain dreams, like there are certain ways that people have of suggested ways of dealing with nightmares, of actually trying to stay asleep and trying to let the dream finish. And if the dream can finish, sometimes it shifts out of the nightmare into something that's more of a resolution. Certainly I've had that personal experience, and and we've had other guests on the show who've suggested that as a remedy for nightmares. And I just want to kind of scoot into this last topic here that Dr. Mageo suggested is nightmares. Like, what are they for? Why do we have them?
Well, I think they have to do with threats to our identity.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh.
So there's an important evolutionary idea of nightmares, that they come from, they're an attempt to think through threats, but threats of a bodily nature that humans confronted early in their evolutionary history. But what I think is that as savannas became cities, the most common threats that we encounter are not physical threats. Well, obviously, people do in certain places, right, in certain times. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the threats we're most likely to encounter are threats to our identity. And so,
right. Well, like the dream that you started off with, Jeannette, of somebody who had this poison on their finger that they were trying to smear on you that would kill you, and that was during a transition time of your life, and so that the death there was had to do with your death of your identity.
Right. Actually, but that was kind of, I know this maybe sounds strange, but it was kind of a good dream.
Oh, yeah. No, actually. Well, you know, nightmares. Yay, another nightmare. I mean, there's like there are some way that things are happening. There are, even though dreams can be intense, nightmares, I always feel like I'm always excited to get a nightmare, even if it doesn't feel so good. It's like there's something happening, some change occurring. And and it was interesting, there was a threat to your life, and yet it was a good dream, so it wasn't even really a nightmare per se.
But yes, nightmares are dreams that usually end with the death or the death of the dreamer, or you it looks like you're going to die at any rate.
Mm. Hey, Skylar, while I have you on the line, I wonder if I could ask you the question about nightmares and pandemic dreamers. Did people tend to have more nightmares during the pandemic as opposed to before? I don't know if you had a baseline from before. Or you said that they did tend to resolve more. I guess it partly depends on how you define a nightmare. But what did you find, Skylar?
Yeah, so I didn't have a huge sample size, but I was lucky enough to have this data during the onset. It was the semester of the onset of the pandemic.
Oh, yeah.
So I had pre-pandemic dreams mixed with after the declaration of the pandemic dreams.
Interesting.
And there were a lot of themes of, like, being chased and monsters, and an invasion was a big theme, too, which I think was a metaphor for, it's this invisible virus that's novel that no one knows anything about that you're always subject to, right? Mm-hmm. If you're outside or whatever. So there was a lot of invasion dreams.
Yeah, makes sense. I mean, because that is one of the main ways that we process the threats. And this would be actually like threats to our bodily integrity, not even just our identity. But the pandemic, especially in the early days, we had no idea how fast it would spread, or whether we could even touch anything that anybody else had had touched who might be sick. And all the movies Contagion had Contagion and others had gotten into our mind of how bad it really could be. And so there was actually existential bodily integrity, whether I'm going to survive this or not, not just whether I'm going to be a different kind of person or not. It's not just my identity, but actually my life. Yeah. Well, Skylar, thank you so much for calling. I'm glad you called, and good luck with your studies. And
thank you.
All right. Take care.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, Dr. Mageo, what other topics do you have? We're nearing the end of the broadcast. Is there anything else that you want to specifically mention? I guess I'm going to answer that question by saying that our guest is giving one of the keynote lectures at the IASD conference in July, and you can find out about that at iasdconferences.org/2022. You can read about the conference. And what else is there that you want to talk about in our last few minutes, Jeanette?
Well, we could analyze your dream.
Sure.
There's not really time, but we could start.
Sure. Yeah. Being in the desert, dancing by myself, being in a crowded place and then dancing.
So it sounds like such a wonderful dream, but yes. You associate it with Burning Man.
Right.
You want to tell us about your history with Burning Man?
Yeah, I've been twice, and it has appeared in my dreams like as a constant theme ever since. And it was like 15 years ago was the last time I went. And yet, several times a month, I typically have a Burning Man dream. And I've had a hiatus recently, 4 or 5 months. And just in the last few weeks, I had several back-to-back very, very intense Burning Man dreams. And I don't know what they refer to, but there's something there for me. There's some kind of shift that makes me think about my identity. That may be part of what's going on. Sometimes they're scary. They're always intense, or typically intense. I can't say always. This one was fun. It was intense, but also fun. And just like I could be who I am. I'm up dancing. And I don't care if anyone else is going to dance with me. I'm going to dance.
By the way, I've always been a just go and dance. It doesn't matter.
Yes. All right.
So I'm just thinking, just throwing things out. So that, in my experience, I mean, that kind of identity, I don't care if anyone else is dancing, identity is wonderful. And in a way, it fits in this society, but it there's always resistance too, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's always asserting against something. And I'm just, you said it might have to do with identity. And I don't know. How do you think it has to do with your identity? How is what goes on in the dream also something about your identity?
Well, the first segment where I'm in a crowd and I'm worried about bumping into other people, there's like a where I'm kind of kind of holding myself back and worrying about other people. And then the second one where I just don't care and I'm just going to do what I do and I'm not bothering anyone, it turns out. It feels like there's a kind of a transition in the dream from being kind of making myself small and worrying about other people to just relaxing and enjoying myself. And so maybe that's something that, because it's been a long-term thing for me to mold myself into somebody else's vision of who I should be. But thank you. That actually gives me something to think about with regards to that dream. So this is Dr. Jeannette Mageo. And I wonder, how can folks get in touch with you if they would like to ask you more questions?
If you Google me, you'll get to my university webpage, and my email address is on the university webpage.
Okay. That's the Washington State University, WSU?
Yes, but if you just Google Jeannette Mageo, that'll take you to my webpage. You'll get you'll get an opportunity there to click on something that'll take you to my webpage.
Fabulous. Okay. And of course, you can always contact me, Catherine Bell at ksquid.org. So Jeannette, thank you so much, and we'll see you in Tucson.
See you. I look forward to meeting you in Tucson.
Wonderful. Okay.
Thank you so much, by the way.
All right. Bye now.
Bye-bye.
So next week, we will be speaking with IASD President Michelle Carr, whose keynote conference presentation is From Nightmares to Lucid Dreams, How Dreams Impact Our Mental Health. You can listen to the live broadcast Saturday at 10 or catch the podcast replay, which will be released on the Monday following the show. Also, I'll be starting another 5-week series of classes in the Experiencing Your Dreams workshop series on May 23. The topic is How Dreams Change Your Mind. Join this welcoming community of like-minded dreamers and learn how to work more deeply with your own dreams. And you can contact me at Catherine, K-A-T-H-E-R-I-N-E, at ksqd.org. Stay tuned for What a Week. I am Catherine Bell, and this has been The Dream Journal. Thanks for listening. You can find out more about my dream coaching practice at experientialdreamwork.com. If you have a dream you're curious about, contact me to sign up for a free introductory dream consultation. So thanks to Rick Luffel, Tony Risimano, Eva Milady, and this outro music is Everything by Mood Science. When you wake up tomorrow morning, take a minute to look within. Do you remember a dream? Write it down and bring it to the next Dream Journal. I am Catherine Bell, and you are listening to KSQD Santa Cruz.